Welcome back to another class. In this class, we are going to learn another type of memory system which is called as cache memories. So what do you mean by cache memory and what is the operations that will be carrying out in your cache memory? In the last class, we had discussed about the main memory consideration, how it was been working in the main memory. Since main memory is slow compared to the speed of the processor, so whatever the instructions which is being given by the processor, we need to go and fetch in the main memory, and then that data will be sent back to the processor, and then the execution will be taken place. So it consists of a time consuming task. So we moved on to overcome this constraint, we switched on to a new design technique called as cache memories, in which the access time can be reduced to access the necessary informations. So how you will be reducing the access time? So before going to learn the accessing time reduction, we shall know about how the cache memories is being placed in your processor. So in your processor, the cache will be placed between the main memory and the processor. So between the processor and the main memory, your cache memory will be got placed, and the cache memory will be small comparatively to your main memory. Fine. So whatever the data you will be storing in the main memory, you cannot fit all the data contents to your cache memory because it is a smaller one, and also it is an temporal storage. Means whatever the data you will be storing in cache will not be stored permanently. So it might be erased after sometimes, or when the cache is full, you might be replacing the data with another data. So that is why it will be calling it as a temporary storage and the smaller storage comparatively to your main memory. Then what is the use of cache memory? So whatever the data which is been requested by the processor, instead of going and accessing in the main memory, if that instruction or if that data is been frequently used or repeatedly used in your program, means you will be placing such data in your cache memories, and directly accessing from the cache will be reducing the accessing time. So that is how, why you will be using up your cache memories. Fine. So how you will be mapping the data contents from your main memory to your cache memory is by using the locality reference. So locality reference is nothing but the data blocks which is being present in the main memory. You will be referencing that location or that locality to your cache memory also. So that will be called it as locality references. Locality references is nothing but whatever the data you will be storing in your main memory will be get copied on, will be that locations or will be referenced to the cache memory also. That is why it will be calling it as locality reference. Fine. Moving on to the next process, that is the mapping function. What do you mean by a mapping function? So mapping function is nothing but the whatever the blocks of data that is being present in your main memory, you will be mapping that to your cache memory, isn't it? That function you will be calling it as mapping function. So you will be mapping the data that is being present in your main memory to the cache memory. So that type of mapping technique will be called it as mapping function. And again, in this mapping function, you will be having three more variations, that is direct mapping, associative mapping and set associative mapping. So we will be looking that things in your next sections. So now at this stage, you will be knowing what do you mean by mapping function is nothing but moving the contents from the main memory to the cache memory will be called it as your mapping function. Fine. Next, coming on to the operation of your cache memories. So how the operation of the cache memories get operate? So what is the thing that is being carrying out in the cache memory? That whatever the request which is being made by the processor will be going and accessing in the cache, isn't it? So if the requested data which is being made by the processor is being present in the cache itself, means you will be calling it as hit. Understood? Whatever the request made by the data, if that data is being present in the cache, means you will be calling it that process has hit process. And what operation you will be going to carry out? The main two operation you will be going to carry out is read and write, isn't it? If you are for carrying out the read operation, that is, if the processor makes a request to read a data from the cache memory, means then you will be calling it as read hit. If you are carrying the operation is write, that is, the processor wants to write a data to the particular cache memory location, and if that location has been found it out in your cache, means you will be calling it as write hit. Understood? So if the requested data or requested thing is present in cache, means you will be calling it as hit. And if you, whatever the operations you are going to carry out, whether it is a read operation or it is an write operation, you will be calling it as read it and write it. Fine, understood? And also you will be finding called the thing called as read miss and write miss. As I already told, if the data is being requested by the processor, if I found it in cache, means I will be calling it as hit, isn't it? So what happens if I doesn't find it in cache? So I have missed it, isn't it? So if whatever the data which has been requested by the processor, if it I doesn't found it in my cache memory, means I will be calling it as miss. If my operation is for read, then I will be calling it as read miss. If my operation is for write, then I will be calling it as write miss. So I have requested to perform a particular operation, but I have not found that data, or I have not found that particular memory location. So I will be missing my operation. So I am failed to execute that operation. So I will be calling it as read or write miss. Fine, understood. Next is the write through protocol. So what do you mean by write through protocol? Yes, the next is your write through protocol. What do you mean by write through protocol? So whether if your it is your read operation, yes, whatever the request made by the processor, if it does not found in cache miss, you will be calling it as miss, isn't it? Next, if you does not found it, what you will be doing? You will be going to your main memory and you will be searching for your particular data which has been present in the respective memory location, and you will be fetching that data and coming back to the processor. Isn't it? That was the thing which will be going to happen. Next, suppose if you are going to perform the write operation. So whatever the data you want to write it to your particular memory location, that has been present in the cache itself. So what you will be doing, you will be writing or you will be updating the contents to the cache memory as well as to the main memory simultaneously. So whatever the data which is in cache is the replication of the main memory, isn't it? So you will be moving that block of data to cache memory. So if you get updated in cache, means obviously you need to get updated to the main memory also, isn't it? So that is what, if you are updating the data simultaneously in your cache as well as in your main memory, means you will be calling it as write through protocol. Understood? So you will be carrying out the function through both cache memory and your main memory. So that is why it will be called it as write through protocol, whereas in your write back protocol only the updations will be taken place in your cache memory. That is, whatever the data you will be wanted to write to your particular memory location, you will be writing to your cache memory and you will be going and carrying out the execution. Next, whenever the data will be removed from the cache and it is moving back to the main memory, so at that time you will be updating that data. So that is why it will be calling it as write back protocol, or you will be also call it as copy back protocol. Understood? So you will be not updating the data simultaneously in your cache as well as your main memory. At first stage you will be updating in your cache memory, and in the second step, that is when it has been removed from the cache and when it you are going to move it in your main memory, at that time you will be moving the data from the cache to your main, sorry, updating the data from the cache to your main memory. So such type of updations will be done through write back protocol or copy back protocol. So that is why the name here, write through, means you are updating both through, that is through the cache as well as through the main memory, whereas in your write back you are updating only in cache, and back means you will be updating after the operation. When the cache data has been removed and it has been moving to your main memory, at that time you will be making the updations which has been returned by the processor request. Understood? This is what the operations that will be taken place in your cache memories. So next, also you will be having certain variations in your cache memories. So what is that variations of your cache memory? So in your previous class you might have been discussed that the cache has been two variations, that is your primary cache and the second one is your secondary cache. So you will be calling that as level 1 and level 2 cache. Again, the primary cache has been, sorry, the cache memory has been divided into two types, that is the primary cache and the secondary cache. Whereas the primary cache will be present in the memory chip itself, that will be embedded in the primary memory chip itself, whereas the secondary cache will be present in the intermediation of the processor and the main memory. So what might be the contents will be placed in the primary as well as in the secondary cache? Yes, again the instructions or data which is been most frequently used, that datas will be moved in the primary cache, that is your L1 cache, and less frequently used comparatively to the primary cache datas, that datas will be stored in your secondary cache, which is been called it as level 2 cache. So by using this differentiation, again the access time by the processor can be raised, isn't it? So again, if the processor makes a request, again I need to go and search for your cache memory. Again, it might be some time consuming task. Still, I need to increase my accessing speed. So what I did, I again divided my cache memories into two variations, that is the primary and the secondary. So in the primary, the most frequently and repeatedly used datas or the instructions that will be stored in your primary cache, which will be called it as level 1, and that will be embedded in your processor itself. So it does not need and go and searching in your memories itself, it directly it will be present in the processor and it will be carrying out its execution. Fine, this is what is all about your cache memories and whatever the operations that will be carrying out in your cache memories and the variations of your cache memories. Fine, so moving on to your next topic, that is the mapping functions. moving on to the next topic, that is your mapping function. So as I already discussed, what do you mean by mapping function? That is moving the block of data from your main memory to your cache memory will be called it as mapping functions. So how you will be mapping the certain blocks of data of your main memory to the what? Cache memories. So that is, there will be of three types of mapping techniques. The very first is your direct mapping. So what do you mean by direct mapping? As the name itself is indicating, it is a direct mapping. So consider in this example, we have taken the cache memory of size, block size 127 blocks. Each block is capable of storing 16 words of data. As well, the main memory is of having the capacity of 4K blocks, that is each block is capable of storing 16 words of data, that is 64K size of your main memory. So in this, the complete 4095 blocks cannot be fitted into the main memory block, isn't it? So you will be having the certain cache memory. So how you will be mapping the blocks to the cache memory? Since as the name itself is indicating, it is a direct mapping, you will be mapping the blocks of main memory to the blocks of cache memory. That is, block 0 is always mapped to block 0 of cache memory. Block 1 is always mapped to block 1 of cache memory. Likewise, the block 127 will be mapped to block 127 of cache memory. Now it reaches with 128. Now there is no 128 blocks in my cache memory. So what I will be doing? I will be moving my block 128 again to my block 0. 129 to block 1, again 255, likewise 130 to block 2, likewise block 255 to 127. Likewise, in this order, that is in sequential order, I will be storing all my blocks of main memory to the blocks of the cache memories. So that is why the name has been called it as direct mapping function. So I am directly mapping 0 block to 0, 1 block to 1, 2 block to 2. So you might ask the question that the complete main memory blocks, how can it get fitted out with cache memory? No, it cannot get fit out with cache memory. As I already told, I will be not storing all the contents of the main memory in the initial stage itself. What I will be storing? Only the contents which is been repeatedly used by my main memory, that contents I will be storing in the cache memory. Here, suppose if I am using the block 0, block 127, block 129, only these three blocks contents is been frequently used. So what I will be doing, I will be moving the block 0, block 127 and block 129, these blocks to the corresponding blocks of your cache memories. Fine, this is how you will be mapping the blocks of your main memory to the cache memory, which will be called it as direct mapping technique. Understood? Fine. Next, coming on to the main address, since it is a 16-bit addressed memory location, the higher order bit of your main memory address will be always representing the tags of the each block. For each block you will be specifying the tags. So the higher order 5 bits will be specifying the tags of the cache memory, and the next 7 bit address will be representing the particular block of the main memory, and the last 4 lower order 4 bits will be representing the particular block. In that particular block, the respective word where the actual data operations need to be carried out. Understood? This is how the main memory address mapping will be taken place. Fine. So next type of technique is associative mapping. So how the associative mapping techniques will be get worked down, how you will be moving the contents from the main memory to cache memory. So let's look on how it is gets worked out. On to the next type of mapping technique, that is your associative mapping technique. So how the data will be mapped from the main memory to the cache memories? Yes, before going to look on it, why we have shifted to mapping, associative mapping, why we had not used with direct mapping? Yes, there are some of the flaws that you had found in your direct mapping technique. What might be the drawbacks? That is, whatever the data that was being stored from main memory to your cache memory, that is, as I already told, consider from the block 0, block 127 and block 129. These are the blocks which might be frequently used by the processor. So I was placing that blocks in the cache memory. So what happens in your direct memory? Block 0 should go and fit in block 0. Block 127 should come and fit in block 127. Again, block 129 will be come and fit in block 2, I think. Isn't it? Like that it was been happen in your direct mapping technique. So from block 0, next data I need to fetch was block 127. So the previously the left out blocks which is been used, which is not been used, it was been left freely. So this was one of the drawback that you had found it out in your direct mapping technique. Instead of wasting the blocks, if I use the block in the next immediate block of the cache memory. So that is why to overcome that drawback, you moved on to a next type of mapping technique called as the associative mapping technique. So in your associative mapping technique, what you were doing is you were not mapping the block 0 to 0, 1 to 1, no. You will be directly mapping the blocks in a random way, that is in your sequential order, how the data will be executed frequently. So if the block 0 is being get executed frequently, you will be storing it block 0. Next, if block 129 is being executing frequently, means you will be storing it in block 1. Next, if 256 block is being executed frequently, you will be storing it in block 2. Understood? Like this, you will be storing any number of blocks of main memory to any blocks of the cache memory. So by this, you can reduce the number of unused space of the cache memories, which was been a drawback in your direct mapping technique. So this type of mapping technique will be called it as associative mapping technique. Understood how the mapping was being done? It was not being considered the respective blocks to be get fit into the respective cache memories. Any number of blocks in the main memory can fit into the any number of the blocks in your cache memories also. Fine, understood. Next, coming on to the memory address of the set, associative mapping, that will be having only two fields. The first is your higher order address bit, the 12 bit will be representing the tag field of the cache memories. So, in which tag the actual data word which the processor is being made requested is being present, and the lower order 4 bits will be representing the corresponding word of the particular tags. Fine, understood. This is how you were mapping the data from the main memory to your cache memories. Fine. So let's look on to the last type of your mapping technique, that is your set associative mapping. So what do you mean by set associative, and how the data is being mapped from the main memory to the cache memory? So let's look on how it has been working out. Last type of your mapping technique is your set associative mapping technique. So there is no much difference between your associative mapping and your set associative mapping. So whatever the mapping techniques you were doing from the main memory to your cache memory, the same thing will be done in the set associative also. So what you were doing in your associative, any number of blocks can be mapped onto any number of the blocks in your cache memory. This was how the mapping was done in your associative, isn't it? So in your set associative also, you can block, you can map any blocks of the main memory to any blocks of the cache memories. So next, why it has been called it as set associative? In cache memory, here you will be having tags for each block of the cache memories, isn't it? So you will be grouping the couple of tags, that is the two tags, group of two tags, you will be making it as a single set. And you will be giving the name for each set as 0, 1, 2, 3, like that you will be giving the set numbers. Okay. So instead of having two tags, you will be grouping two tags as a single set and you will be giving the name to that particular set. So likewise, you have grouped all the tags and you have made them as sets. In the cache memory, how many blocks you were found it out is in this example, you have 127 blocks. So 127 tags you were there in the cache memory. Instead of having 127 tags, you have reduced the 127 tags to 63 sets, isn't it? So instead of if whatever the request made by the processor, if I need to go and search in my cache memory, instead of searching 127 searches, I have reduced my search operation to 63. So this is how I reduced the number of searches and also I increased the access time. So that is why the name will be called it as set associative. Whatever the mapping which was been done as if like in the main memory will be moved to the cache memory. But in the cache memory, you have reduced the number of searches by making the groups of tags called as sets. So that is why it is being called it as set associative mapping technique. Fine, understood. So in set associative mapping technique, the group of tags will be made it as set and each set will be given as the number. So instead of searching all the tags, you will be searching the number of sets. So the number of searches also got reduced and the access time got increased. Isn't it? So coming on to the main memory address, again your 16 bit address is been divided into three fields. The higher order 6 bits is been used to represent the particular tag of the cache memory and the next 6 bit is been used to represent the particular set number and the last 4 lower order bits will be used to represent the word of a particular block. So this is how I reduced the contents of my memories or the reduction of access time and increase the processor speed. Understood? So the cache memory itself will be increasing the processor speed. Again in the accessing time and processor speed was being increased. Again to increase my accessing time, what I did, again I divided my cache memory into two variations, that is your primary and secondary cache, whereas most frequently used data was been present in primary cache and less frequently was it been present in secondary cache. So again my access time and processing speed got increased. Again in my mapping functions also, in your direct mapping again my cache size was getting wasted. So I have shifted on to my associative mapping. In associative mapping, I have overcome the drawback of my direct mapping, and in direct mapping, again I was need to searches for 127 searches. So again I found an idea to reduce the number of searches. So what I did, I grouped the tags of each blocks into a set and I reduced the number of searches, that is the number of searches which was 127 to 63. So this is how I was used my cache memories to reduce my access time and also to increase the processor speed of execution. Fine, understood. This is all about your cache memories and mapping function techniques. And in the next class, we are going to learn about the virtual memories. That is the next variation of your memory system. How the, again, if I need to need to increase my memory size, what might be the variations or what might be the actions I can draw up to increase the size of the memory. So we shall discuss that in your next class. Thank you all.